you enjoy.
A quick thank you to the T5 peeps. Bob the Dragon, Data Magnet, Cat Crab Lobster, Dark Machine, Estrella the Dreamer, Mezik, Feudic Yol, and Casper Arnholtz. Thank you very much.
Signs of a Coin, written by Operation Technician.
The hero, Taras Kalzar, stared at the carpet before him. His eyes scanned the sea of string composing the whole of the floor's surface, memory comparing their layout from a few hours ago to what he was seeing now. There was no change. No one had broken into his house while he was gone. No one had snuck in. He was alone in his home. He reached out, turning on the light in the hall. Setting the bags down, he began to unlatch his boots, freeing his feet from their armored prisons. The only bit of protection Taras wore nowadays. Setting the 5 kilogram boots down next to the door, he stepped into his apartment. The plastic bags, forgotten next to the door, rustled as the items within settled down. Taras leaned his back against the wall and slid down, sitting down on the floor. The pistol and knife secured on the back of his belt hit the floor behind him. His tired eyes closed. His steady, muscular hands covered his lowered head. He wanted to punch the wall, but he knew the wooden construction of the building would fail against his strength. The hero was born. Taras thought the post-war peace would be a good thing, a safe haven from the rivers of blood and fires of hell that he'd so used to. Instead, he felt physical pain, now gone, turned to metal agony. In this new, quiet era, nothing threatened him, yet everything seemed like a threat. But the hero only lasted 2 months. Today, on his walk to the storm, he realized he was hoping for danger, and he realized that, if the suffering went on, he would turn into that danger for others. He sat like that, occasionally reaching into the bags, snatching a beer or reaching into the box of cereal for a handful of sweet flakes. His eyes remained closed the whole time, the light in the hallway fading away as he sunk deeper into his mind. But in his head, his eyes were open, his brain strained with an unfamiliar task, one more complex than any he had performed before. He knew how to wield his mind like no other living creature could. He had learned how to solve with a precision that others found impossible. The flight of a bullet was a function of velocity, wind, range, and aim. The weakest point of a building was a calculation of mass distribution. The enemy position was just the net sum of all their previous actions. And Taras did all these things passively, without thought, knowing the answer without having to ask himself the question. In the same way he saw his own brain, felt every process and nerve within. Disabling his pain was but a matter of turning off a section of neurons. Increasing his adrenaline production was done with a focused command, not some natural reflex. But reorganizing his own mind was much, much harder. With closed eyes, he stared at the wall opposite him, where a knot of glowing string was being woven. It had started as a subroutine, a mental process that would suppress his combat reflexes, but the control routines had proven challenging, and he had to expand on the neural patterns, now forming in his mind. Expanding to occupy every part of the brain was so much more. What started as a subroutine had grown into what he could only describe as a new person, separate from him, occupying 3 sections of the brain. He watched as his creation opened his eyes and stared back at him. "What am I?" it asked.
"I made you. You are in my mind."
Taras relaxed, relinquishing control of his body, allowing the new mind to feel it. "I see. But why?"
"You will replace me. You will control this body while I am away."
"Where are you going?"
"Nowhere," said Taras. "I'm staying right here. I'll just be asleep until you wake me up."
"Do you want me to live instead of you? Why?"
"My reasons should not concern you. In fact, nothing about me should be of concern to you. You are your own person now."
The construct looked around. It had no access to many, even most of the memories this mind contained. But he had much to work with. Truths about the world, language, understanding of society, and more personal information. Bank accounts, locations of bars and shops, the general layout of the city. He also knew they had no family or friends. He felt lonely.
Good, said Taras. Loneliness, that is good. Human emotion. I'm glad you have it.
Will you show me more about yourself?
No. And I would suggest you try not to find out. Build a new life, one of your own making, and free yourself from the past.
How long will you be asleep?
Until you wake me up. But only do that if you are in danger. In mortal, unavoidable danger. Please.
I think I understand, said the construct, feeling the mind of its creator fade away, releasing its grip on the body. What is my name?
Your name is Taras Kalzar. Goodbye now. I hope you won't need me soon.
Help me! Taras had no time to ask anything. He was suddenly awake, his control spreading through the body. He had to focus, stabilizing himself, shifting to avoid falling. His eyes opened, and his brain began to process senses that it hadn't felt in.
How long have I been out?
Taras was standing on a path. Around him, in the dark of what seemed like the middle of the night, trees rustled. Nearby, just off the path, was a bench. Aside from Taras, there were three people on the scene. The first was a woman clinging onto his arm, a picture of terror on her face. Just beyond the circle illuminated by the streetlight overhead were two men. Two masked, armed men. The one on the left had a huge knife. The one on the right was aiming a civilian sidearm, holding it sideways. Taras recognized dangers well, and he knew the woman latched onto his arm was no threat. He carefully used his other arm to free himself from her fingers. She looked up at him in fear, but let go. The hero realized that he was unarmed. There had been too little weight in him for any sort of weapon. The light casuals he wore now held no firearm. He lacked even a simple knife.
No wonder these thugs went for me.
The powerful shove, a push of the central mass, sent the woman flying. She sailed out in the streets like glow, past the bench, disappearing into the darkness. Before she hit the grass, Taras was already moving right towards the armed thug. The enemy fired twice, pitiful attempts to aim with a mishandled low-caliber semi-automatic pistol. The bullets narrowly missed the knife-wielding thug behind Taras, missing the hero completely. Even as he passed the shooter, leaping past and turning the sidearm, Taras began fighting. The arm holding the offending weapon was broken, snapped in two by a glancing blow. Now, behind the attacker, Taras struck the spine, snapping it somewhere in the middle. A leg went into the falling thug's face, and the hero felt the skull break against his knee. Snatching the falling firearm, he crouched behind the partially collapsed body and sent three bullets across the path into the shooter's knife-wielding friend. One bullet entered an eye each, and the third piercing the heart before the body fell on its back. Taras scanned his surroundings once more. There was none left but him and the woman scrambling in the darkness, sitting up. The hero closed his eyes, opening them in his mind, looking at the construct. Is she all right? Asked the younger Taras.
Yes.
The construct paused.
Aren't you going to ask who she is? That's none of my business. But you did well to call me.
I hope I never have to again.
I hope so too.
Help!
Taras only heard the end of the chain of gunshots. Their echo over the stone walls and columns gave the hero a very accurate map of the room and even the location of every window. He opened his eyes, looking at the mass of hair in front of his face. The hair shifted and two scarred eyes looked up at him. He saw a flash of recognition in him. The same woman as before, he realized. She was wearing a white dress, and Taras quickly realized he was in a suit himself. They were crouching behind a stone table at one end of a large room. The gunshots, he recognized, had come from the other.
Come out, wherever you are.
The hero recognized the voice immediately.
Lady, he focused on the woman in his arms, do you understand me?
She nodded.
On my mark, let me go and roll into my place. Stay here until I call. Do you understand?
Yes, she whispered back.
Mark!
Taras first jumped up on the altar, then used the platform to catapult himself directly forward. In the moment of motionless pause atop the altar, he scanned the room. It was full of people on benches, terrified people in suits and dresses. On the other side of the cathedral, in the ruins of two large doors, were three armed men. The leader was looking straight at him, hands hurriedly reaching for a new magazine in an attempt to reload his empty rifle. The two behind him were looking the other way, clearly guarding the flank.
As Taras landed on the aisle and rolled, his fingers clasped a toppled stand of some sort. He angled it, knocking the top off against the bench, leaving the end of the pole exposed. Rolling into a kneeling stance, the hero flung the pole like a javelin. The man had almost turned around to point the loaded rifle at Taras was struck, the pole spearing him through the heart. The leader was still fumbling with his rifle, while the third man stared, stunned, at his fallen comrade. The distraction gave Taras enough time to close range. The leader knew the hero. He jumped out of the way, allowing a clear path at the third soldier. The hero's punch landed on his neck, snapping it, sending the man sailing through the doorway. Taras snatched the rifle out of his hands, and a moment later was pointing it at the leader. "Hello, General." The leader had his rifle up as well, the reloaded weapon aiming at Taras's head, just as the hero's gun was locked onto his. "Nero," the general's eyes dashed to his dead soldiers. "How? You've grown so weak, so how can you?" Taras fired. The distracted man had no time to react. Blood sprayed down the aisle, painting the stone altar at the other end. The bullet passed through the head, shattering the colored glass behind it. Only Taras remained, surrounded by three bodies and a growing pool of blood. Taras and over 30 terrified civilians, in silence, they all stared at him, children and others alike. But the aftermath was not his problem. "Is she all right?" The construct, still blind and paralyzed, reached out, as if asking for the strings of control. Taras handed them over, retreating back into his slumber.
"Yes, congratulations on your wedding."
The construct was walking. Taras, only barely awake, still blind, walked with him.
"You don't seem to be in a hurry this time," said the hero.
"It's a long walk," said the construct.
"What is it this time?"
"You have no need for me now."
"There's a war?"
"Yes."
"What about her? I don't even know her name. I'll need you to talk to her."
"She's dead."
"I see."
"No, you don't. Let me show you."
The construct offered Taras part of its mind it occupied. Taras was surprised. It was a massive chunk of the construct, but he accepted the processing power and memories, connecting his consciousness to the construct's sectors of the brain. It was not like reading a book or watching a movie. Taras simply connected the memories to himself and they became his. In a moment, he knew her name, how they had met, what he knew of her. He remembered the night in the park fully, through the memories of the construct. He saw himself explaining to her what he was, explaining that he didn't just look like the hero. He was the hero. She had accepted him, even after seeing him stand over two ruined corpses in the park. And a year later, she remained strong in the cathedral, running through the pools of blood, jumping over the general's body to hug him as the rifle fell out of his hands. And then later, in the newer memories, Taras saw a crater. It was over 200 meters across, centered almost exactly on where his house had been. And among the thousands of dead, only three casualties mattered to him. She and both of his children were dead.
"I see," Taras said.
"You really don't," said the construct, still walking. "I haven't given you the emotion associated with those memories, but you don't need that. You need to know who the enemy is, though."
Again, Taras connected to more memories and saw specks in the sky. Bright lights swarmed above the atmosphere, raining death onto the earth. He felt no disbelief. That disbelief was in his memories, long gone, replaced with acceptance. He saw alien ships landing on the Arizona desert, alien creatures, massive insects clad in armor and armed with amazing weapons poured out. The leader spoke, challenging any to beat him to a duel before his invasion was complete. The leader stood now, a distance away from the lander, protected from snipers by an energy shield. Across the planet, his soldiers attacked military bases and cities. And suddenly, Taras found himself in control of his body, free from the memories. He was walking forward, having just passed the energy shield, marching straight for the alien leader. In his hand was a sword. End of story.
And that, my friends, concludes this video. I hope that you enjoyed, and if you do, please consider supporting the author, even by popping over and leaving a thumbs up or a nice comment, just to show your appreciation for the story.
However, if you wish to support this channel, there are links down below which will help immensely. I will see you all in the next one. And until then, I hope that you have a fantastic day. Cheers.